A warm welcome to everyone. We, the people of Prakriti, the Techno Environmental Club of NIT Durgapur, strive to make a difference and inoculate the seed of awareness and action in the mind of prospective engineers to make this environment a suitable place for every living being. Our motto is to change the notion that engineers do not care for environment into making every individual on campus a green engineer who minimizes the risk of pollution that might be caused with new inventions or breakthrough researches in technology. As a club, we imbibe to the values of Mother Nature has taught us: perseverance, sustainability, and progress. Right from its rootage, Team Prakriti has met through those ambitions of the founders of our club and crossed many milestones ever since its onset. We conduct our events throughout the year, reminding and awakening the slumbered minds the importance of environment and its preservation. Today, we gathered here to have an eminent session of e-talk with our honorable chief guest, Ms. Sumaira Abdul Ali ma'am. Sumaira Abdul Ali ma'am is an environmentalist born in 22nd May 1961 from Mumbai, India. Founder of the NGO Awas Foundation and convener of the movement against intimidation, threat and revenge against activists, Mitra. She was co-chairman of the conservation subcommittee and honorary secretary of Asia's oldest and largest environmental NGO, the Bombay Natural History Society, and is currently a governing council member. Through legal interventions and advocacy and public campaigns, contribution to documentary films, television debates, and press articles, she has successfully mainstreamed and built consciousness about previously unknown environmental hazards, notably noise pollution and sand mining, and has won national and international awards for her work. She also set up the first network for protection of activists in India after an attack on her by the sand mafia in 2004. She has been referred to as one of India's foremost environmental activists. Sumaira Abdul Ali ma'am has been called the Indian Minister of Noise by government offices and by the press. Let's give a warm welcome to Sumaira Abdul Ali ma'am. Now I would like our dear president to show her gratitude by expanding a welcome wish.
Thank you, Vihan. It's a great honor, ma'am, to welcome such a noted personality for our event Green Sermo 2.0. So on behalf of the whole family, Prakriti, the Techno Environmental Club, I extend you a charismatic welcome, Sumaira ma'am. We are all overwhelmed to listen to your tales of hard work, dedication, and indeed your courage in working through all the odds and in a dream of having a better green tomorrow. Last but not the least, I welcome and extend my thankful gratitude for all the participants to be here. So without any delays, we are quickly coming to you, ma'am. And we would like you to take us all on your journey and enlighten us with precious words as we begin the event. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for that introduction and for your welcome. I'm very happy to be here and to speak to all of you. It's always a pleasure to speak to young people. And it's so nice that we're able to do it online. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yes, ma'am.
It's always nice to be able to speak to young people, and it's especially nice now that it's online, that it's possible to speak to young people who are in different places, which is much more difficult. So I'd like to make a presentation. If I can please share my screen.
Yes, you can.
You'll have to guide me through this, because you are the technical experts, not me.
Ma'am, in this meet section, there will be a upward arrow sign.
Yes.
Ma'am, you have to press on that.
Okay.
And you have to press your entire screen or a window. then your presentation will come up. Right. And you have to minimize your Google Chrome for that purpose.
Okay, can you see it?
No, ma'am. You have to... Yes, ma'am. Now you, it is visible.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, can you see the screen now? I'm just going to put it on slideshow.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay, so I'm just going to speak to you about some of my work and about, I mean, you introduced it so nicely by saying that how young people can help with technical solutions. It's an engineering college and there's always solutions to every problem. But first you have to understand and recognize the problem. So I think 2021 has been a very important year for the environment because we have had the convention of climate change, which took place in Glasgow. It's just got over. It happened in November, which I'm sure many of you already know. But even in 2020, before lockdown, when coronavirus made the environment come so much to center stage and made us all realize that how important environment is, because just a small virus, which people say is a result of wildlife disease transmitted to humans, even before that, in 2020, it was clear that the effects of climate change were being felt everywhere. But when everybody was sitting at home during lockdown, it became even more clear because we could see that the air pollution levels changed, the skies became blue, there was less noise pollution, and there was the connection between environment and economics and technology became very clear to many people who normally didn't think about it. So in 2020, this is something I wrote for Forbes just before lockdown. And then everything changed with lockdown. And you can see that in lockdown, there are shots here of Mumbai completely silent and how things changed, that everything became silent. And we came to realize what lockdown means, why environment is important, and why we need to find solutions, why we need to factor in the economy, not only with growth as in GDP growth, but with the environment which makes it. And of course, young people have been so vocal. They have been leading in many ways the environmental discourse to the extent that they were the ones who made the climate change conference one of the most important ones ever. So I'll talk to you about my work and how some of my work perhaps will inform what you can do in future. So one of the issues that I have been working on for the last two decades and more is sand mining. And when I started work, no one knew what is sand mining or why sand mining is important, because everyone said that there's more than enough sand and you don't have to worry about it because the sea always brings in more sand. It's everywhere. Even the world as plentiful as grains of sand describes plenty. And in fact, our whole growth will stop if we don't have sand, because sand is used for everything that we do. But I knew that this was not true because it happened on a beach near my house. And this is a campaign that we did, Don't Bury the Issue of Sand Mining. This is a beach where 20 years ago, I first saw sand mining happening. And you can see that as a result of sand mining, this is a few years ago, just before lockdown, how much the land has eroded and how we are losing biodiversity, trees, and how the, you know, saline water ingress ruins the groundwater table. So this is what happened when I first realized that sand mining was an issue. This was the beach near my house. I saw the sand mining happening. I knew there was something to be done. I approached the authorities and they said, you have to catch them red-handed, because if you don't catch them red-handed, we don't know who's doing it, which was strange because everyone in the village knew. But apparently the authorities didn't know or didn't want to know. So I did catch them red-handed. This is something we redid later to show this is the exact spot where I was attacked for the first time. and I was hospitalized, and I realized that there was, on the one hand, people said sand mining is not important, forget about it, there's plenty of sand. On the other hand, people are willing to attack you. So this is the first time that I stopped a truck, and it's only after this that the issue of sand mining became more known. I went to court, I filed public interest litigation, and I realized how little information there was. So I started visiting sand mining sites and filed public interest litigation in 2006. In 2009, we got an order to stop sand mining all across, first the coastal areas, then the whole state of Maharashtra, until such time as the government came out with an actual policy. But the day after the order, I got a call from someone in a village. This is Mahad, which is in Maharashtra, in the Raigad district of Maharashtra, to say, come and see what's happening in our area. And I went there on this boat, and I saw that there was industrial scale sand mining. And this was the first time I had seen mechanical sand dredging happening on the river with conveyor belts and, you know, all kinds of equipment. And I took these photographs. These were the first photographs of large scale sand mining. And I was attacked again. There was this very dramatic high-speed chase through the mountains. There were two SUVs. There was an accident. They tried to push us over the bridge. I was driving. And finally, with great difficulty, this is in the police station. When the police tried to file first a complaint against me for rash driving rather than against them for attempted murder, which happened later. You know, when somebody attacks you, when they attack you twice, particularly, you have to decide whether you want to continue or you want to give up. And I felt that if it's so important that people are really willing to attack you like this, then it's worth doing. So I you know, persevered with my case. This is sand mining at the Vaitarna Railway Bridge in 2013. You can see these. This is a different type of sand mining again, because these are suction pumps. So the first sand mining I saw was on the beaches. The second time was using those industrial type conveyor belts. And this looks the simplest because it's just a fishing boat with a little pipe. But actually this is the most damaging because it can work continuously through the day and night and through all kinds of seasons. You can see it's happening at the very foot of the bridge, Vaitarna Bridge. And there were complaints by the railway authorities that it was eroding the bridge. It's completely illegal, but no one stopped it. The attacks became more obvious, more visible when there were more attacks on various other people, including on government officers. So in Virar, not so far from Vaitarna, where I showed you this picture just now, the sand mafia tried to actually mow down a cop while they were raiding this sand mining site at night. In other districts, in other states, there have been much more serious attacks. I talked of mechanical dredging and manual dredging. The manual dredging looks much more difficult. It is much more difficult, though less damaging. It has a different dimension because there are huge human rights violations that can happen as a result of manual sand dredging. And this was an investigative story done by Reuters Foundation to investigate how these people in Thane Creek who dread sand manually dive down. And so it looks very innocuous. You can see how close it is to the city. It's right there. There's building happening all around. It's very shocking that this very building, which is using sand, is actually also destroying the creek, which it's next to. You know, we say riverfront properties are very valuable, but if you're going to ruin our rivers and beaches and creeks with sand mining, and that also so close to it, and no one knew it was happening. This sand mining happens manually. You can see these people here, they dive down more than 50 feet without any equipment in tidal creeks. Sometimes they get washed away. Sometimes they have to be drunk to be able to withstand it. I'm told that unless they damage some kind of veins and arteries in their foreheads, which bleed, unless they have blood flowing out of their nostrils, they can't do this work because of the pressure that they work under. It's extremely polluted. So there are a huge number of other issues, human rights issues, also as a result of sand mining. In Mahad, where I had been attacked for the second time in 2016, this bridge was washed away. Right under the bridge, there were sand dredgers found. A number of people died. Some buses, other vehicles got washed away. And right under the bridge, there were sand dredgers found. They had been lying there. It's not so far from where I had investigated sand mining way back in 2010. But after this bridge got washed away, we were again told that no, sand mining has nothing to do with it. It's completely independent. This bridge was just old, and the sand did not damage the foundations of the bridge. This was said without any investigation. So again, it was a question of checking what's happening at Vaitarna, what's happening at the other railway and road bridges where sand mining is taking place, and you're building these bridges and constructions using sand, because sand is an ingredient of cement concrete, which is used for everything that we build. But we are destroying the very material we are building by mining sand, and we're ruining our natural beaches and creeks, which are the barriers we have against climate change and sea level rise, by building, overbuilding. So again, sand mining at Vaitarna Bridge, you can see there's a train going on top. And these are all manual mechanical dredgers, suction pumps. This is the sand actually piled up under the bridge. I presented the issue of sand mining for the first time to the United Nations in 2012. The Convention of Biodiversity was in Hyderabad. And it was so surprising to me that the United Nations, which at that time said that coastal issues are among the most important issues that we have because of sea level rise, because of so many other things, but we don't have a single paper on sand mining and we don't know anything about it. But sand medium of all these other issues, because mangroves grow in sand and migratory birds use sand, fish, breeding sites are in sand, the bottom of oceans and rivers and creeks are sand. But yet no one knew about sand mining as late as 2012. So the issue started in India. In 2016, this film was made, Line in the Sand, by the Australian Broadcasting Corporation, where they documented the sand mafia, which I've talked about. A number of other attacks and murders had taken place all over the country. I was lucky. I'm still here to talk about it. But some of the other people were not so lucky. And this is the sand that I'm showing you, that this sand is the sand used for building, because this sand has been worn down by tidal action or by water action, rivers, whatever else. Desert sand cannot be used for building. That sand which has been ground down by wind action, and it's very smooth, it has rounded edges, it can't be used for construction. And the surprising thing is that even places like Dubai, for example, have to import sand because desert sand can't be used. So Dubai, when it makes its buildings and when it built the Palm Island, such islands, imported its sand from Australia. I think this is why the Australian Broadcasting Corporation was so interested, because it's their sand which is being exported. In fact, sand mining is because of the sheer volume and quantity of building that is happening all over the world. Sand is the second most extracted material in the world after water, and it is one of the largest traded and used commodities in the world. It's used for making concrete, glass, computer chips, just about everything that our civilization stands about on. And yet, we don't know about sand. So sand mining, we need an estimate of the supply and demand mapping. This is again in 2016. This is a function that we held. And till now, the supply-demand situation has not been given to us. The government has announced recently a $1.3 trillion Gati Shakti building plan, but we don't know where the sand is coming from. We don't know how much sand is going to be required officially. We don't know whether we have that quantity of sand or not. And there are mafias operating, which means that the government is not even making money on it, because when they give a license, the sand which is extracted is 10 times that much. And to fulfill a $1.3 trillion building plan, you can imagine the amount of sand that we need without knowing anything about it. What's the solution? So what is sand? sand is some kind of material which is ground down into uneven particle size. It can be rock, which is naturally ground down. It may be shells. It may be a mixture of many things. But it can also be waste materials. And this is where the engineering part of it can come in. Because the waste materials, India not only leads in construction, but the second largest user of sand in the world. China and India between them have used more sand in the last decade than the entire West has used in the entire 20th century. So we have a huge demand for sand. And this part, these particles which can be used can be made out of various things. And garbage is one of them. India, apart from having a huge demand for sand, has a huge stock of garbage. And that can be used to build sand. So when I addressed the UN for the second time in 2018, virtually, this is their very first conference on sand and sustainability, which was held in Geneva. I addressed them virtually. I gave the keynote address. And in that, the conclusions they came to was that India has the capability of leading the world in finding the solutions in alternatives to sand, which will actually be solved not only the issue of sand mining, but it has the potential to also solve the issue of using waste materials. And the UN, after this particular conference in the part of 2019, they actually, the UNEP held their main meeting, and they included a resolution for mineral mining governance, in which sand mining for the very first time was included. And in that thing, they included all the recommendations we made from India, including using satellite tracking mechanisms to see how much sand we have, in tracking it in terms of the transport, because that's another area where there's a huge amount of possibility of corruption, in finding ways of tracking how much sand is going to be used at the time of actually figuring out a new project, and in figuring out new types of ways of substituting natural sand by using crushed debris for different types of applications. So the material you will need to build a skyscraper building of, say, 100 floors or whatever will be completely different from the kind of material you can use to build a low-rise building, or to do interior work, plastering, stuff like that. So various things can be recycled in different ways to meet different demands. And this is the 2019 Sand and Sustainability Report of the UN for the first time. I worked with Professor Shyam Osalekar of IIT Bombay, who in the PIL that we had filed in 2010, presented a paper to the Bombay High Court. This is much before the UN got into it, saying that there was a possibility of using different types of aggregates to substitute sand. And at that time, the Bombay High Court had ordered for the very first time the government to look into these alternatives. Professor Asalekar worked on it with his PhD and master's students for 10 years. In 2019, he said that the cumulative wastes in India, that means garbage dumps like Deonar and other, where pollution is a huge problem, like air pollution, does have enough waste in it, and that waste can be recycled to meet 100% of India's needs, according to what he estimated, to meet our needs to build. And he estimated that we have 1,200 million metric tons presently locked in legacy landfills. He estimated that India's demand for sand is 60 million metric tons per year, and that includes everything that we want to build. He estimated that there are approximately 78 million metric tons which are required as fresh, which require to be disposed of according to the solid waste management rules of the government itself, and that 100% of this can be used by figuring out different ways of doing it. Now it's up to us to make sure that we put in enough resource into the R&D to do this, to mainstream it and make it happen. When I was young, we believed that without coal and oil, everything will stop, that the whole world will stop, because only coal and oil can drive energy sources. But we know today that there are so many other types of energy which are available. When solar energy first came about, it was extremely expensive. Today, there are countries like Germany where solar energy is cheaper than the normal energy, that is the coal-based energy, and they are substituting 100% of their energy with coal. India is not doing that, although in many ways we are world leaders in solar energy. We have technology, very innovative models, NGO models, formal models, and we know that solar can be cheaper than coal today, coal and oil. If only we put in enough money into developing our own technology, our own way of doing it. Similarly for sand, we can save sand. We can lead the world. We have the ability. We have the brains. We have everything going for us. We just need the will. So we need to save our sand and we need to move forward. This is not the only example where things can work technologically. Noise levels have reduced again in the 20 years I've worked on it to become their lowest in 2019. This is again before lockdown. Of course, after lockdown, during lockdown, there are many reasons why noise levels have become even lower than they were in 2019. But the reason for showing you the 2019 levels is to show you that it doesn't take only coronavirus. It can happen even otherwise. And again, there are many parallels between the way that you work on reducing coal by solar energy, you work on reducing sand mining through technological solutions, including garbage, and you reduce noise levels, because the policy levers are the same. The will to implement is the same. And again, these are issues which are little known when you begin. So just like people laughed at me when I said, at first that sand mining is an issue, and they said, don't waste your time, spend your time on doing more important, better things. People also laughed at me when I said noise is an issue. But in Mumbai, decibel levels during festivals go up to 123.2 decibels with loudspeakers. They go up much beyond this when firecrackers are used. When I first started measuring noise from firecrackers, they exceeded 140 dB, and 125 dB is the threshold of pain. Beyond that, in a few seconds, you begin to lose hearing. It's not only during any particular type of event that noise levels are extremely high. It happens at every festival, and each person has to begin with themselves, because you can see at Eid Milad, it's 113.6. At Ganpati, it was 123.6. At festivals, which include New Year, which include private festivals, sometimes birthday parties, weddings, it used to go up beyond 140. And it's gone down. Mumbai was the noisiest city in the world at that time. These are the global standards. And look what the World Health Organization tells us. It tells us it should not exceed 55 decibels in the day and 40 decibels at night. This is in a residential area. After that, they have revised their standards downwards, whereas we are struggling to meet this and saying these are impracticable standards. But when you have impure drinking water or bad air quality, you don't say, Indians can tolerate it because we are somehow built differently and we like it. No, you say that, this is really harmful because physically, physiologically, we are all the same, whether you're in Germany or in India. We need to start working at incrementally bringing the levels down. In 2017, Delhi had the highest number of hearing-related noise losses in the world. Mumbai had the second highest. In 2021, March, the WHO had the first World Hearing Day, and Dr. Harshvardhan, who was then our health minister and an ENT surgeon, said that India faces an impending mountain of hearing loss and that we need to take action to figure out ways to stop this. Again, these are the noise rules. They are based on the World Health Organization thing. The solutions are technical in many ways. We had the first No Horn Day in the country in 2008, we partnered with the traffic police. But of course, it's the traffic police who are one of the greatest sufferers themselves, because they are the ones who stand on the road. So training the police, creating awareness, checking the decibel, the hearing loss of the traffic police, we found that more than 70% had significant hearing loss because they stand there exposed night and day, and they will tell you how much they suffer. Firecracker tests with the Pollution Control Board, I've told you already that they were above 140 dB, but over the years, the decibel level of crackers has gone down because people have come to realize, and the manufacturer, I mean, when you talk of awareness, awareness is not just of people on the road. Awareness is of authorities and of judges and of courts and of implementing authorities and of policymakers. And of course, of engineers like you who come forward and find the technical solutions. So there have been solutions which have been found. Some of the solutions have been green crackers. There are still many problems with the green crackers, but at least they are better than this. The decibel levels of crackers have gone down through technical solutions. We need a lot more, but it's better than nothing. There's awareness. In noise pollution is a serious health hazard. It's not just an environmental hazard. Honking doesn't make your car move faster. It affects your blood pressure, your hearing, your heart. 27% of the overall population of India suffers from disabling hearing loss. 48% of Indians over 65 years suffer disabling hearing loss. 12.3 million children and 18.8 million adults of this region suffer hearing loss. This is far greater. It's the highest hearing loss in the world. It creates mental health issues. Psychiatrists say it can create feelings of frustration, rage, irritation. It causes adrenaline levels in your blood pressure. It can give you stress responses, mental health illness. Honking hurts your heart. Doctors say that it can give you high blood pressure. It can give you heart attacks. It can make already ill people much more ill. We partnered with the Indian Medical Association. They joined us. It can even give you cancer. We partnered with the police. We partnered with auto rickshaw drivers, with children, with citizens, with police. Again, more no honking days. We partnered with them to create awareness. We partnered with auto rickshaw unions. We partnered with the press. We did a six-month-long campaign with the Times of India, with many other leading newspapers to create awareness. And people at least now recognize that, yes, hearing is a problem. And this is the Chief Minister of Maharashtra. Let's put noise pollution behind bars. People ask, aren't you afraid when you go out and start taking noise levels? You know, people would say, just one noise meter in your hand, can you really change a whole system, a whole way of looking and thinking at things? But in Mumbai today, if you complain about noise pollution after 10 p.m., people respond. And you can see that here I am on a street festival taking noise levels, and people say, aren't you afraid? But everybody is worried about their own health. And I'm very touched that people whom I thought would be opposing me, they did oppose me, of course, I mean, for years. But in 2018-19, after the court orders, the actual presidents of the Mandal associations, the Eid Milad associations, the Ganpati Mandal associations, other associations came forward and said, we understand it's in our own interest and that you have no ill will against us. I have no ill will against anybody because I feel the people who are standing there making the noise are the first. And so you can see that they're asking, how is it affecting us? Is it hurting us? And they have come forward voluntarily, given up DJs in Mumbai. The police, who laughed at me and said we have more important issues like crime to tackle, have partnered. Gods against noise. Every religion, every god talks of peace, samadhi, moksha, all those things. Nobody talks, no religion talks about making noise. So this is the message of peace. It comes from everyone, everywhere. Was it easy? Of course, it's not easy. It's our more difficult things which are more challenging, which are more important, which are worth doing. The Karma Yoga tells us that you have to try. You have to keep working. Whether it happens or not, you don't know. Did I know when I started working on sand that it would become an international issue and I would present to the UN and that they would say that India can lead the world or that there is a way or any of that stuff? No, I didn't. Did I know that this, there would be something called a citizen's noise map that one day you can download a free app on your phone. Anybody can take a decibel reading, that there will be something called Twitter, that the police will have a Twitter account that people can complain in enough numbers that the police feel inspired and motivated to take it up and set up systems where they take the action and citizens complain directly. And so I have much less of a role to play, except maybe just, you know, figuring out or telling people that this is what works and this is what doesn't. I don't have to do the implementation because it's a citizens' movement now. They do it and the police set up their systems. It's time for action. We've had a lot of awareness campaigns. We have a lot of court orders. Many things have worked, but we also need more enforcement. We need more technical solutions, like we had these solutions of the apps which were developed of figuring out ways that you can have different types of aggregates. People have come forward, young people figured out ways of controlling honking by having horns which cut off after a certain number of horns, or having horns which can charge you beyond a certain number of honking. You know, today we have control rooms linked up. We have apps which do traffic violations. We need to figure out the technical ways of linking honking with the police mechanisms of finding people, of you know, different ways of doing things. I don't know the solutions. You know the solutions. You know how to handle social media better than me. You know how to do those things. As a result of all these things, Mumbai is the one city which celebrated the quietest Diwali in 15 years in 2019, again, before lockdown. Of course, during lockdown, things were completely closed. So it was much more quiet again. It was quieter than it has been ever since I've ever measured, only in Mumbai. Other cities violated the rules. In Delhi, there was a complete ban on firecrackers. Noisier than us, smokier than us, worse than us, because people had not realized that they can control noise and other types of environmental damage, that health is a reason for control of the way you live your life, whether it's celebration or other things. And in Mumbai, they obeyed it. There are many other things you can do. It's not only noise and air pollution. It holds true across the board. There are so many things which many young people find much more exciting. It could be sustainable fashion. In my old age, again, just before lockdown, for the first time, I was never asked when I was young, but I was asked to walk the ramp at Lakme Fashion Week. I took my decibel meter with me because I wanted to say that there are so many things that you can do, and it doesn't change the way you live in the world. You can be an engineer, you can be a doctor, you can be in social media, you can be in advertising, you can be anything at all. You just have to be yourself. You interact with the world, whatever you do. And I know my daughter and her generation wear recycled shoes and clothes made out of plastic, made out of hand looms, that it's a matter of pride for them, that mainstream fashion houses have given up using fur, for example, and other materials which are damaging, that youth have stood up against diamond mining because it destroys forests. They prefer to wear sustainable fashion. And there are so many ways, and it's not for any other reason, but I would like to support you in that. And therefore, I agreed to do this and to demonstrate in my own way that it's not just going and getting beaten up by the sand mafia. It can be anything at all. You are a part of the environment. So thank you, Mumbaikars, and thank you to everyone in the country who has participated. This is a hoarding that the Mumbai Police and we put up after Diwali in 2016. As early as that, because that's when the change really started to happen, and it's been happening over the years continuously. Thank you, Mumbaikars, for choosing Diyas over crackers. And that's not all. Thank you to Mumbaikars and all the young people and other people all over the country who believe they can make a difference in whatever walk of life they are, in whatever way they are. Again, remember the Karma Yoga. It matters what you do. You don't know what result will come out of it. I never thought one day I'll be speaking to all you wonderful budding engineers, and hopefully maybe some of you will feel inspired. aspire to take it to levels and places which I can't even imagine in the future through technical solutions of which I have no idea. So thank you very much, and good luck to all of you. I'm always here if any of you need any help, anything at any time.
Ma'am, it was a great inspiring story. We all feel inspired from your journey, and I hope all that are viewing are getting inspired by your journey. I do have questions, some questions. Ma'am, for my first question is that as we know that your upbringing, like childhood upbringing, was from Japan. So can you, like, is there any effect on you, like you are very like, what can I say, rigid in your decisions and your motive? So do you think that living in Japan has influenced your journey or something like that?
Well, all of us are influenced by where we live. So I've lived half in Japan and half in Mumbai. So both of them are, I mean, in a way, it's a culture shock both ways, because they have very different ways of doing things. The Japanese are very disciplined people. They have placed a great deal of importance on nature. And, you know, those kind of things. Indians have a different way of doing things. So I think if you can take the best, I don't know whether I took the best, but whatever lessons you learn from everywhere that you experience, different things that you experience, is all good. It's up to you how to, you know, what to do with them. And so I mentioned the Karma Yoga. So, of course, India is a very important part of my upbringing and the way I look at things. But I also know that the Japanese have something called Bushido, which means that you do your duties. In a way, they're similar, but the approaches are different. The way of doing it is different. So I don't know. I mean, I'm sure it had its influence on me. But if you ask me which one influenced me, how much and how and what, I don't really know. It's kind of a hodgepodge of everything. And that's true for each and every one of us. Because we grow up in a particular place, then we have different influences on our lives, which continuously keep changing as we grow. And I think we should be open to all these influences and take the best out of whatever you can. Most importantly, the influences and the times that you think of as being your disasters, because you think this is the worst thing that could happen to me and maybe I'll never get over it, actually are very important learning lessons. And you may not realize it right then, because, I mean, you tend not to. I know I didn't. I thought many times over that now, you know, this is really the end. I can't do this anymore. But when you are a little distant from it and you look back, if you look back without bitterness and think how everybody has been bad to you, how horrible it was, how wronged you've been, you'll find that you've so much to learn from those experiences. And I include being attacked, nearly killed in them. Because the thing is, I could have been actually killed, in which case I wouldn't be here talking to you. But I am here. And, you know, there's no doubt that there was a lot to learn from those experiences.
Ma'am, now we'd like to take the questions from our audiences who are viewing this.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, so let me read out a few questions for you. The first question is, how a general guy can join or help Aavas Foundation? Is there any way that a common guy can join?
Well, there is no formal way to join. But, I mean, the fact that you're asking me the question, I hope means that you will contribute in whatever way you can. And by contribute, I don't mean that you have to come here and work under my instructions. Although, if you'd like guidance, I'm always here. But I think that you guys have a lot of ability to innovate. And in fact, you will discover the solutions yourself. I'm here to help you, you know. So please feel free to reach out. I'm on social media. I'm not very good at Instagram. I've asked young people to help me do a slightly better job because I'm not very good at it. But anyone who wants to volunteer in any kind of help is always welcome. And on the other side, if you need help in any kind of way, like, for example, you want to know, you know, maybe something, some experience that I have, or something like that, how to figure out something, feel free to reach out on social media, on email, on phone, whatever, WhatsApp, whatever.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for answering that question. And the next question is, how this challenging journey started and what incidents or feelings made you to work here with all your heart for every aspect of our ecosystem? How that courage, dedication, and determination come?
There's a very fine line between courage and stupidity.
Yes.
So I don't know what you would call it. I knew it was dangerous to go and stop a truck in the middle of the night, but I also knew that if I don't do it, that the beach where I grew up was being ruined in front of my eyes. So I don't know what you'd call it. I would not advise any of you to do something like that. But again, when you face it, you have to take your decisions. And when you're attacked in some way, it may not be a physical attack. It may be some other kind of attack, you know. Laughter, someone laughing at you is an attack, I would say. So whatever the type of attack, you have to decide whether it's important enough for you to do it or not. But I would also again repeat that it's important to recognize not doing something is doing something too. So it's up to you. And the way you live your life is going to impact who you are and what you do always. So if you decide not to do something, that's a decision too. And you will have to live with the consequences, whatever that may mean, whether it's climate change or whether it's losing your beach. And you have to decide whether that's worth it or not. So I think that's the only, it's not particularly bravery or courage. It's just a matter of doing something that's required, which is in front of you. And that's your decision. But I would say it's better to do than not to do.
Yes, that's really motivating. So let me move on to the next question. What, according to you, is the biggest threat to the environment today and how can we overcome it?
Well, clearly it's climate change. But because climate change is such a large issue, people tend to switch off because the idea is, what can I do? I'm just one person. But climate change is made up of a whole series of small actions. And just like when I started working, or never mind stopping the truck, but the decision to file public interest litigation in the High Court, it was a hopeless thing to do. The decision to take a handheld noise meter with someone donated to me and say, I'll take noise readings because there isn't any data, was kind of really a useless thing to do. Everybody said, it's just ridiculous, you know, don't do it. Because you need an organization, you need help, you need structure. What's even going to be the use? But it was better to do it than not. So I just feel that don't give up thinking that it's just one person. You do what you have to do and it will come out of it. And that's the way almost anything is built. I think as engineers, you know that discovery you make of the small thing that you do, you don't know whether it's a big thing or a small thing. You just know that you're doing it, right? Because you're engineers and because you have to do it. So keep doing it.
Sure, ma'am. We will definitely keep that in mind. We'll definitely strive to make the difference. It's our duty to make the difference.
It's your duty to yourself. It's your duty to yourself because if you don't do it, you live with the consequences, you know. I live on a road which was like a garbage dump when I moved here. And I decided to clean it up. And so I built, there were some trees, and around those trees I planted a whole lot of shrubs. If you come to my street now, people tell me it's like a garden. And I say, it's my garden, it happens to be a road, but it is like a garden. And the trees outside, which I look after as if they were in my garden, but they're on the road, I see the birds every day, and I wake up in the morning and I see those birds, and the person who benefits most is me.
Yes. So, ma'am, what do you think the important lessons that should be part of environmental training program and why?
The most important lesson is that what you do matters. I think nothing else is important. There's a whole lot of technical things that, you know, people will tell you, trees give you oxygen, climate change comes about as a result of air pollution, that there are solutions, that there should be mitigation measures, that there should be alternates, there should be recycling, circular economy. I've spoken about some of those things. All of that is true. But the most important message of all is that it's in your hands to do something. You will be the politicians of the future, the technical people of the future. You will make the policies, you will mainstream them in the businesses that you design. You will make sure that the grows in the way you want. So whatever my generation determines, ultimately you will determine the future. So I think that's the most important lesson of all. And I think that's not a lesson I'm telling you. That's a lesson which young people who stood outside COP26 told the world leaders and made them listen. So actually, I'm just repeating your own message to you.
Ma'am, I had a question. It is like, why environmentalist? Why not any other profession? What motivated you to go into this sector?
Well, I don't know why not any other profession, but this just happened to be in front of me. I had very young kids when I started, and you know, just like I'm telling you, it depends on your situation, your life situation. I wanted to do something which wouldn't take too much time and which I could do while looking after my kids from home. So this seemed like a good thing to do because I thought, well, in the few hours I have, I'll just volunteer and do a little bit of work. So I ended up working at night before the kids woke up, you know. And that way I could do it. If I had had a full-time job or, you know, done something, I wouldn't have been able to do it in that particular life circumstance I was in. And all of you are in different situations, but whatever situation you are in is okay. So I think there's no good answer that I chose this because I wanted to be an environmentalist. I think you're an environmentalist, whether you know it or not, in anything that you do. So I was a mother and I was an environmentalist.
Ma'am, you are the perfect example of keeping balance in your various things you do and various daily life activities. So what do you give as a suggestion to us youngsters, ki how to keep a balance between the things we do?
Well, I think that's a very actually important question, and I'm not sure how to answer you because it's a very difficult question. You know, I think in the world today, a lot is expected from our youth. We expect the youth, and I said it just now, that we expect you to fix all our mistakes. We expect you to excel in your professions. We expect so much. And I think the first answer is to be kind to yourself, you know. It's better to do what you can do, what you're good at, than try to do something that you can't do and you're not good at. So maybe if I had tried to be an engineer, I would have spectacularly failed and also lost self-confidence because I could not have done it. That's not my skill. So I think if so long as you're doing that thing which you think is motivating you, you'll always be good at it. And that can be being a mother, you know, like I was. And like I am, and looking after the environment that I felt strongly for on the side. Again, I didn't know that my actions are going to result in making me competent to speak to you and tell you anything, or, you know, in kind of being considered an expert on anything. I was doing what I wanted to do. So do what you want to do, and you will be better at it than trying to do something you're not.
Okay.
And that means also that there will be times in your life, there have been times in my life, I will say, when I have, for short periods of time, neglected my family, if you want to neglect. And they have understood, because they've understood that I feel really passionate and it's important to do it now. So I've worked 24 hours a day, I've not slept. I've done all those things which you guys are doing now. But the important thing is to remember that you also need to take a break because you can't keep that up forever without burnout. So you can do that for some time and then say you do it for a week and then say now for a week, I'm just not going to do anything. And I do that a lot. So people say, you must be very busy. And I say, well, sometimes, not always. Because a lot of the time, you need time to just rest your brain. And it's in, you know, the eureka moments come in the rest periods. They don't come when you're very busy and implementing. They come when you switch off and you have time to just not think about this and to, you know, do what you're enjoying. So remember that, that if you're not working, it doesn't mean your brain has switched off. Your brain works in the background. You need to be kind to yourself and give yourself a break. So when you talk of balance, I think that's very important. And I think maybe that's something I learned in Japan, that you need that time just for yourself, doing nothing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Whenever we think about environment crisis, we'll just think about global warming or deforestation like that. And sand mining doesn't come to our mind. Do you think we should give more attention to the sand mining?
I'm shocked that even the UN didn't know what is sand mining, given that if you say the second most extracted material in the world after water, then I don't know why it isn't center stage, because we're running out, you know, given the kind of growth models that we have. We have the raw materials. We just aren't paying any attention to it. So, yeah, I definitely think so. And I think it's a huge opportunity, as these things are, you know. These things, anything which is a major problem is always a major opportunity too, by its very nature, because it wouldn't be a problem if it didn't have a solution. Most problems have solutions. So it depends how you're going to look at it. So yeah, I do think that it's going to be a huge opportunity for someone.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question from the viewers is, where you, along with your volunteers, see yourselves in the future? Any new domain to introduce or something to be emphasized more?
I don't know. I think I've managed to kind of bring these two issues that I've worked on into, I don't know whether they're mainstream, but certainly into more consciousness than they were before. And I think that the way I would see myself in the future is hoping to get more people from different sectors to join and take it forward, because obviously no person can do everything alone, nor should they. So you need the inputs, from technical inputs. You need people good at awareness creating. You need everybody on board. Nothing can happen alone. So long as I can be useful to people who would, you know, to guide them and help them, I think that's what I would really want. I don't know that I really want to take up 10 more subjects. I don't think that's going to be as useful as maybe motivating other people to take up those 10 more subjects, which I may have no idea about. I think 2 is enough.
Thank you. Now, let's move on to the next question. After facing so many difficulties, being attacked or charged, the journey has not been easy. So what was the major support or motivation that has always pushed you for the work you are doing?
I don't know. I can't answer. I think your motivation is just that you look around you and you see that it needs to be done. I mean, the more you do, it's like, well, you can't give up now. And of course, attacks in themselves are a motivation to someone like me, because it kind of highlights that it's something that should be done, that needs to be done. I think if things are difficult to do, they're satisfying, you know. And particularly if you don't really expect a result, that you're not doing it because you want to do, you want to know that if this is going to lead you step by step to success. If you're not that interested in the success, I think it keeps you more motivated than if you think, well, I failed here and this didn't work out and maybe I can't do it, you know? Although that happens too.
Yes. Ma'am, so what do you think, ma'am? This pandemic is a boon or a curse, according to you?
Well, clearly it's a curse on many people. I mean, people have suffered so much that it's impossible to call it a boon. But there are some silver linings.
Yes.
In that, we have figured out how important environment is. And we have given ourselves a break from the madness of the world. You know, it's been very tough for young people who have not been able to get jobs, who have, you know, they've had many setbacks. Everybody has had, but young people have had special setbacks, I think, in their career opportunities. But maybe it has also given people an insight into what a different way that the world can be in future. So I'll call that the silver lining. And again, it depends on us how we decide we want to take the world further and how we're going to make it happen.
Yes, ma'am, sure. How modern technology can be used to save environment?
You tell me. Because you guys are on the cutting edge of it. I've given you some examples of what can be done. But I think how it can be done, I have no clue. You tell me.
Ma'am, a thing that I wanted to like mention. Ma'am, if we see in the textbooks, like in our government issues textbooks, state government, central government, or even if we see NCERT textbooks, if we see the pollution chapter, it is like of 30-40 pages. But there we can get it, so only a half page of noise pollution. What views do you have about that?
Definitely, that needs to be corrected. So it has been on my mind many times that I should do that. But, you know, there's a limitation to how much one person can do. And again, you need inputs from every sector. Because to write an academic chapter, I'm writing a book. I'm writing for magazines and newspapers. I have court cases going on. Of course, I have help in all these things. I'm not doing it alone. But again, this is something in which definitely I would need help. It's impossible. It's not that I may not be able to do it, but you can't do everything. So yeah, it's a very important thing to be done, clearly. And, you know, when people ask me, how can we help? How can we volunteer? Well, again, I think you have the answers. You can do any of this. I'm there to guide you, to help you. I want these things to be done. Even picking up the phone and making a complaint about noise is volunteering. Or writing a post on social media and tagging me, in a way, is volunteering. Because it helps, you know, the message to spread.
So, good evening, ma'am. So the question that I have is, like, now the other markets from other countries are shifting from China to India. So we can expect rapid industrialization and all. So how can India grow sustainably, keeping the environmental aspects and the industrial aspects balanced?
Well, I think India has great capability in many respects. We have the technical capabilities, we have the intelligent minds, we have everything going for us. All we need is the will. You know, if you spend $1.3 trillion on cement concrete development and you don't spend anything close to that on technological innovation and solution, then you're never going to be able to do it. And you know, the kind of budget that we have, 2,000 crores for environment and 1 lakh plus crores for cement concrete building doesn't balance development and environment. Put some amount of that in the policy measures, in the development of new technological capabilities, and I think we can do it. We can figure out the ways. I showed you Dr. Asulikar's inputs that we have the raw material for just one aspect of it. Building requires sand. Building cannot take place. And when you talk of building, when you're talking of development, a lot of it is construction. So when you talk, government is the biggest builder. So when you're talking of construction, you're talking of sand, that immediately makes a difference, that you're finding out ways to do it better. Cement concrete is a huge emitter of greenhouse gases. Garbage dumps are a huge emitter of greenhouse gases. So you're tackling air pollution again there. The UN has said that air pollution is the biggest health emergency faced by our planet. And it's ahead of COVID-19 as a health emergency. It also creates climate change, the biggest driver of climate change. So coal. So again, finding these ways alongside the development is crucial. Just following, you know, what the West has done, they have created this climate emergency. We have rightly said to them that they need to pay for it. But we shouldn't wait for them to pay, because we can do it ourselves. We don't need to wait for them. It would be so wonderful to come up with a solution where we come to them and say, look, we're doing it without you. We're showing you the way. We are not repeating our way. Today, they've built in this terrible way where they have created this climate emergency. They're spending huge sums of money demolishing what they have made so that they can repair what they have done. And we want to catch up with them, repeat those mistakes, and then again be forced to spend money, time, infrastructure, development of a new kind in breaking that down and rebuilding. If we can build a little more slowly and build better, I think we can show them how to do it. Then they will not only give us that $1 trillion that we want from them, but they'll do it because they have to, not because we're asking them to. Because they want to follow us. And that's what I would like to see India.
And the next, another question is like, now everything is technology-based and everything is going on phones, laptops and all. So the major component in every electronic device is a chip, which is also made of silicon, which majorly comes from sand. So how do you relate, like, at if the devices are increasing, then at one day we will not have sand for anything we do. So what are your views on how to do, what is to be done?
Well, this is why we need to take an inventory of how much sand we have and where it's best used. You keep building, you keep breaking down things, you throw away that sand, you mine more sand, you keep building again, you are going to run out. It's better to categorize sand and say we have this much. It's required for, you know, virgin sand is required for a certain application. Reused sand can be reused for different applications. Maybe just because it's cheapest today doesn't mean it's cheapest in the long run. It's better to spend a little more money today. Anything that you construct is going to be more expensive than that thing which is lying out there free, you know, for some mafia to go and just take. But that's a very worthwhile investment in the long term. So are we thinking short term? Are we thinking medium term? Are we thinking long term? So I think I can't answer your question because that depends on our policies, how we want to construct our policies. If we want to finish up all our sand right now, then we are going to spend a lot more later, as the West is, in demolishing what we're doing today and figuring out new ways. Or we can decide that maybe we slow down a little bit. We don't construct as quickly, but we construct better on a more solid base. And to me, that's a no-brainer. But unfortunately, maybe I'm wrong and they're right. I don't know. People think otherwise. They think it's more important to first catch up and then see what's to be done. I don't agree.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, what's the most rewarding experience you have had while working in environment sector?
I don't know if there's any one experience which I can say most rewarding. It's very rewarding to be here talking to young people. As I said, I never thought that such a thing could happen.
Ma'am, like keeping the technological advancements in perspective, like the automation in cars, self-driving cars, and these are all in trend now. So one day in near future, all the cars will be communicating so that there will be no requirement of horns and all. They can be automatically moved. So will this type of advancement reduce the levels of noise pollution as it is now?
I have no idea, because in India, horns are not used for their primary purpose, which is safety. They're used because we want to make noise. So we use horns to celebrate New Year. If you go to some places, you'll see everyone's sitting on their horns. They use horns to say I'm happy now, or I'm sad now, or just sometimes to say, well, here I am now. Or so I don't know. These are all social changes. There's a technical aspect and there's a social aspect, and they go together because the technical messages and the social messages have to be in sync. You know, the technical inputs will be driven by what people want, and the what people want will be driven by what's available. So again, I don't know. It has the potential, definitely, of stopping honking. And that's the way it should be used. But the technical inputs on their own are not enough. You need both. And that's why partnerships and synergies are so important. And that's why when people say that, is social media activism useless? I don't think so. I think it's very useful because social media has given people the ability to reach out across sectors where they wouldn't normally meet people. You know, engineers stick to engineers. Media sticks to media, somebody sticks to somebody. But through social media, you can reach out through many different types and groups of people together. And that's what has to drive the change, the synergy.
Ma'am, what's the most effective way to reduce noise pollution?
Just don't make noise. You know, start with yourself and go outwards from there, because the most disheartening thing is when people say that, well, you know, I'm doing it because someone else is doing it. So stop them and then I'll think about it. Because mine is just a little bit. It's just for a little while. Or I have a very good reason for doing it because it's traditional, or because horn, you can't drive in an Indian city without honking. Everybody does it. Or, well, you know, young people like parties, and if you don't have them, they're spoiled sports. Or I mean, if you want to find reasons for doing something, you can find any number of reasons to do anything. In ancient Rome, they used arsenic and lead to whiten their skin, which today you can't even imagine. But you can blast someone with very loud noise and make them deaf, and that's fine. Although that's physical harm too. So again, it's how you define things, and every person has to start with themselves. I don't think preaching to somebody else works as well as you doing it, setting the example, and then telling the people around you. It's also very important to be completely impartial, because noise is it's a physical reaction, and it doesn't matter who you are, where you are, whether you're young, you're old. Yes, there are some physical reasons why infants and old people are more affected, but everybody is affected. I mean, that's like saying there are physical reasons why very old people are more susceptible to heart attacks. That's true, but everybody can have a heart attack, you know, if you eat unhealthy food all the time and if you don't exercise and all that other stuff. Same thing with noise, that you may think you're enjoying it, but actually you have to be sure that it's within safe limits. When you use headphones, that they're within safe limits, because if you make yourself deaf through headphone use, then you don't realize that the way you're talking is louder, the way the TV volume is louder, your general day-to-day life is louder, and you're making yourself more and more deaf, which is actually harming your career. Particularly if you want to go abroad later and you find that you're hard of hearing, it affects you. So start with yourself.
Ma'am, coming to the question, ma'am, if we see that every religion has a festival that either makes some noise, every religion, be it India, be it worldwide, be it in China, be it in any country, we can see that in religious festival, they make noise.
Yeah.
So if we go and have to tell something about that, we face many religious criticism and many things. What is your method of dealing with that?
Well, I don't think noise is a religious thing at all. I think that, you know, there are all religions evolve, and all communities and ways of life, and, you know, the way we live today is not the way we lived in, say, the 10th century. You can't even imagine living in the 10th century, you know. And loudspeakers didn't exist in the 10th century or in the 15th or 20th. You know, loudspeakers were invented in the late 1800s. And so they are modern technology in a sense. And when you say noise, there was a time when the clock tower in Bombay was considered too noisy and people complained because it was too noisy. So yes, every religion makes noise, but the level of noise has become harmful. Like many other ways of life, in a modern life, have become harmful because they've become in excess. So no one is saying don't enjoy, no one is saying don't celebrate, but it's the method of celebration. And what we have forgotten is that, say, loudspeakers are an invention of the late 1800s. But the late 1800s is old technology. Steam engines are the invention of the late 1800s. Do we still depend on steam engines? No, but we still depend on loudspeakers. Today, we have mobile phones, we have just so many ways we can celebrate, use technology without making noise which disturbs others. So why in this one technology are we stuck? We are not stuck in ancient tradition. We are stuck in the 1800s and 1900s. We neither want to move before that, nor do we want to move ahead of that. So I think that's again where behavioral change comes out, that we're just stuck in a particular time warp. And I think we need to do that. It's not a religious thing at all. It's a competitive thing.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, what kind of pollution bothers you the most?
I mean, all pollution, by its very nature, the name pollution means there's no most or least. The ones that you're working on bother you the most because you see them all the time, whether you like it or not. But all pollution bothers everybody.
Yes, ma'am. Let's move on to the next question by the audience. What are your methods for field inspection?
For what?
Field inspection.
I don't think there's any method. You go and you do it. you figure out where you need to go, and then when you get there, you figure out what you need to do. Because if you go with a very preset idea of what you're going to do, then you miss many things. You know, because every situation is different. So I think the most important thing is to just be open to. You may know to some extent what you need to do because of previous experience, your own experience and other people's experiences. Like, for example, my experience tells me that I should not advise you to go in the night and check out a sand mining site. So, but apart from that, you have to figure it out. You know, the situation keeps changing. The world keeps changing.
Yes, ma'am. One last question from all of us, ma'am. What message do you have for all of us youth?
I think I have no message beyond what I've just said, except to wish you all good luck. And again, say that I'm here if any of you need help. All help is welcome. And, you know, it's better to do than not to do. Do what you can. Do, and normally what you can is what you're good at. And normally it's also what you enjoy. So if you're not enjoying it, if you hate what you're doing, stop. That's my message.
Really motivating speaking to you, ma'am. We really enjoyed it a lot.
Thank you. I did too.
Yes, ma'am. Dihan, you can continue.
Ma'am, so we would miss you a lot, but now the time has came to conclude this event and bid goodbye to you all. But before that, I would like to thank you on behalf of us, Ms. Respected Sumaira ma'am, who has graced us with her presence. We are grateful to you for taking out time from your schedule. Thank you, ma'am. This has been an honor to have you with us. I'd also like to thank all the participants who have joined us today. And lastly, I would like to thank all the team members of Prakriti, the Techno Environmental Club of NIT Durgapur, who have worked to make this seminar a great success.
Thank you very much to all of you. And, you know, just don't give up. Do what you can. Don't give up.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for sharing your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
It was very like a hope regenerating meeting.
Good. I'm glad. I mean, we need hope, and we need all of you not to give up hope, because, you know, things are, people will give you dire messages, but you can do it. You can always do it. Don't give up.
And your story is really inspiring. Like, we want to be like that.
You'll be better than that. Don't just keep working.
Yes.
Okay. Good night.
Good night, ma'am. Thank you
Good
so
night,
much.
Ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Feel free to share my social media handles and with everybody who's here.
Yes, ma'am. Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
We'll be tagging you, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.